Hola, 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 hola. Hi, hello, everyone.
Hello. Hola. Hola.
From Gato Negro Ediciones. We are at the very heart of Mexico City at the new location of Aeromoto, la biblioteca Aeromoto. And we are here very happy, delighted to talk about our new book, upcoming book, Salones de Belleza, the Beauty Salons, Readings at Aeromoto, I think is the proper title. This book, we don't have it right now, it's on the press. This is a pre-recorded session. When this is streamed, the book is going to be ready. This book is the compilation of the series of readings organized at Aeromoto in between 2017 and 2020, a series created by Kit Schluter, which is here, and Tatiana Lipkins, Mexican poet, editor, and translator, which is not here. this is a compilation of the readings that took place there. It's a reunion of almost 70 authors. It's a bilingual book, Spanish, English, mostly. We have poems on other languages, but it's not it's just a few. this is a long project since it started this 3 years ago, 4 years ago. He approached us with the idea that at the end of this a book would be possible, and we felt very honored by the possibility to be the ones editing and making this book possible. For us, this is a massive book. It's a collaboration that involves almost 100 persons, and it's a collective effort. This book is a co-edition in between Gato Negro Ediciones with Aeromoto and Wolfman Books, located in Oakland, California. This book is possible with the financial support of the National University. And for us, it's a truly delight that this project is possible. This is the first launch that we have after or during this shitty pandemic time. resilience that we are still here and doing what we think we know to do. I'm going to give the word to Kit, which is like the force behind
the
project that can talk to us about the origin of this project, how you came up with this idea, how did you approach to Aeromoto, please, Kit.
Hi, everyone. I was living in California before I came to Mexico 4 years ago now. And certain friends of mine there and in New York City had spoken to me very, very highly of this library, this arts library that's called Aeromoto, and they'd spoken very highly of the people who ran it. Specifically Jerónimo, who's with me now, Mao Marcin, Maru Calva, and Maka. And I didn't have much going for me, and I decided to come to Mexico, learn Spanish, study Mexican poetry, and try to befriend these strange and distant fellows who had their arts library down here. Came down at the end of 2016 with the plan of slowly ingratiating myself in this community and seeing what would happen. I thought I would come down for 3 months, and now it's been 4 years. And a large part of that is because of the project at Aeromoto. There's a lot of traffic, international traffic, to Mexico City of writers, of poets, fiction writers, translators, you name it, they come here. Not only because it's a fun city, but because there's a massive community of poets, a historic community of poets at work here, and a very vibrant scene that runs from poets in their 20s to poets in their 80s and 90s. And this book actually kind of spans that gamut. There are poets in their early 20s and there are poets in their 90s. So anyhow, Hera and I became friends, and we were spending a lot of times with poets who were passing through town. And a lot of them were American poets. A lot of them were, say, Argentinian poets, Peruvian poets. And Hera came to me with the idea of getting all these poets into the same place, just simply using translation when necessary to facilitate bilingual readings between Spanish language poets and Anglophone poets. And that was in mid-2017, we had the idea, and he approached me with that idea. I said, yes, I would love to coordinate the reading series, which is something I've been doing since I was 23 or so. I think readings offer poets a very unique opportunity to share traditions, to share life experiences, to get off the page, get out of language, and get into presence and friendship and things like that. So the real idea of this project began as much as a social project, a social process, as a literary process, but the two always worked very closely together. There was never an idea that literature in the scope of this work existed outside of our social lives and our social realities. So come the end of 2017, we started to write out to poets. I invited Tatiana Lipkes to co-create the reading series, as she's something of a specialist in Mexican poetry. She's also a translator, so she understands the whole ethic of the project. And together we started writing out to poets we were interested in, poets whose work we liked, poets who we liked as people, and that's people within Mexico and people outside of Mexico. And so begins a long and confusing and wonderful process of the reading series, which is now has been encapsulated in a somewhat sensible, alphabetized, bilingual, facing page kind of way, which was not at all the reality of it while it was happening. The reality of it while it was happening was emails, text messages, conversations over drinks at bars, conversations at diners, comida corrida, conversation, running into people on the street and saying, wow, it would be wonderful if you read. Some people said yes, some people said they couldn't, some people said yes, then couldn't, some people I know Leon doesn't want me to mention this, but they got Moctezuma's revenge and they couldn't come to the readings because they were sick while visiting. It was a whole social reality, a whole process of lived experience and friendships, as complex as a friendship can be. You can imagine the relationship between 92 or so translators and poets who collaborated in the making of this reading series and the book. The readings themselves were very casual. They took place in the old Aeromoto, which was on Calle Venecia, Venice Street, in the Juarez district, in a fairly small space underneath an architectural collaboration like office space, and the walls were full of books. It was art books. They have a wonderful art collection. Anyone who can, I highly suggest you come when COVID is done, if it ever is. Anyways, the readings were very casual. Whenever the English being read, there was a translator who we had worked with to make sure that the work would also be read in Spanish as much as possible. So the room was full of Spanish. It was full of English in translation. It was full of really, I saw it as kind of friendship. And I guess that was for me the most interesting part of the series, was seeing how sort of community friendship could expand through this global movement of visitors to Mexico within Mexico City, and then later through social media, these friendships could continue. And so we believe that these events would be a sort of beginning to not a movement, nothing as pretentious as that, but simply friendships, relationships, which meant that if a poet from Mexico was going up to the States, they would have a place to stay, they would have contacts, they would have someone to go eat with or go to a bookstore with, go to a park with, and they could slowly make friends and share via these conversations that would come out of it, traditions, ideas, projects, books, publications. I don't know, this sort of very simple thing, which is our social reality. And now I think the book can offer this work not only a kind of solid form to enter the world in, but also a new beginning. Maybe translators will read some of this work and become excited, or maybe a press could read some of this work and get excited about it and want to do a whole book. And that sort of idea that we're like at the top of a large hill. It's kind of the opposite of Sisyphus. We weren't at the bottom of the hill pushing a boulder upwards. We were at the very top of the hill trying to move the boulder so it would start rolling really fast downwards. And then Sisyphus would be down there waiting to try to push it back up, but gravity doesn't work that way, socially. Anyhow, that's my idea of the book, of the project, of Aeromoto. And I like to ask Hiro talk a bit about Aeromoto, maybe, give a context of their mission, their project, and also to talk about his own vision of why he came up with the idea for the reading series in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Well, Aeromoto is in... más alto. Okay. Okay, so Aeromoto started as a kind of a social experiment about books. It was me and Mau Marcin, Maru Calva, and Macarena Hernandez, who were just four friends who had this idea of putting together our private libraries, archives, and make them public. So we rented out this little house in Colonia Juarez. That was 6 years ago. It was something that when we started, we thought that it would last 6 months or a year. Luckily, we didn't have any expectations of how it was going to work or how the community was going to respond to that. And the project started getting bigger and bigger. We never wanted to be the one saying what the program had to be or what the activities had to be. So it was, since the very beginning, very horizontal and open project, so the community could come and propose, like ask if they could do a book presentation, a fanzine, a talk, a round table talking about anything. So yeah, we were always pretty open, but since the very beginning, we started having a lot of events. So it became a very social place. So we have this regular library where you can go there and study, read, take the books from long, take books home, but also it had a very social aspect that started growing and growing. And at some point in 2017-18, we had up to 8 events every month. And I think one of the biggest or more popular at that point were Salones de Belleza. People were it was a monthly event that lasted 18 months.
How many seconds?
I don't know. I think it was about 18. And then, yeah, at some point, because we thought it was. We were tired. I know, first we ran out of money. So always that's something that always happened in Aeromoto. Kit was doing this, ¿cómo se dice? Por amor al arte.
For the love of art.
Yeah. He would get 1,000 messages for each session.
After what? That was like
insane amount of work. And thank you. We do it in many ways. But I think it's been a lot of very hard work, but also with this very enjoyable part. So that's why we kept doing it. ¿Qué más? I want to talk about the library a little bit, not only this project. We, at some point, many times, Aeromoto was always on the verge of like collapsing and closing due to financial problems, because of course it's not very profitable to run a public library. And in the end, when the pandemic started, we had to close. At some point, we thought we were done forever. But then we were closed for a year, and now this month we reopened in this amazing 17th century house right in the center of Mexico City. We're in front of the cathedral, Palacio Nacional, Templo Mayor,
Moctezuma.
Moctezuma.
It's a very, very historic location. It was the Palace of Moctezuma. So yes, you are in a very privileged location. Yeah.
A very strong energy down here. Okay, so we love poetas, no?
I would do something.
Great.
First, for Aeromoto, that this is something that I have discussed in public with Jerónimo before, that possibly it's like a long series of unintended consequences of this first effort to have an escape, and that and somehow the story of Aeromoto is parallel to our story. And somehow one of the first mirrors, spaces of interlocution that we found was with Aeromoto. Was a place where there was someone or a group of people reading, and trying to make circulate, trying to preserve the first book that we started to publish in a very unconscious sense, no? Like understanding what about we're doing was the presence and important, no? And we have witnesses and trying to be part of how this space became like a hub, like an important hub of relations, of encounters, not only for the Mexican arts or publishing community, but internationally. No? Somehow there's a natural coolness that attracts people from all over the world. No? and somehow this space in between friendship that also I think I was thinking about this with the channels, no? Somehow, like, if any duty or like a mission, being a poet to build a community around your peers, to at least read and translate your colleagues and your contemporaries. No? And somehow, Aeromoto offers a space to post that reality, to organize. No? And creating this was inertia that somehow this somehow attracted a very diversity of voices and generations that spend space of friendship, primal practice of poetry, which is read each other. And somehow it was very insistent about that this book is talking about that moment. It's like this happy situation. And I would like to talk about a little about this impressive assembly of different voices. That this book we have very well known and recognized writers and also emergent voices. A very different array of approaches to the writing. And would you please talk about a little about this?
So I hear my echo. One aspect of the reading series, as late, was to bring together people from very distinct worlds and different worlds, different social realities, different traditions, different, as I said earlier, people of different ages. And so, yeah, there were people there. There's a Pulitzer Prize winner. There are Guggenheim winners. There are National Book Award finalists. And there are people who had never published poems before, all in the same book. And to us, it's all valuable. And it's not some kind of meritocracy within the book. And that, to me, reflects also an aspect of the social reality of writing, that if you like the work, you like the work, and that's what matters. And so there's a large variety of people in the book. There also reflects a very particular relationship and a very special relationship throughout the book, which is that of the translator and the poet. And so Robin Myers and Maricela Guerrero have been working together for a while now. Robin's been translating Maricela's work, which is really fantastic. And they will now be reading from that work and discussing a little bit the lived reality of the poet and the translator friendship and relationship, and also what that looks like on the ground. So I'll let them take it away.
Hello. It has been such a pleasure even just to listen to Kit and Leon and Jero talking about the gestation of this project, which for me synthesizes a lot of what I have loved most about living in Mexico for about 10 years now, and in being friends with and working with Maricela, who is honestly one of my favorite poets in the world. It's been such a joy to have our both poetic and friend-based relationship expand in these last few years, although I think we met 10 years ago, I think when I had just gotten here. And I think a lot of what Kit describes and Jero and Leon as well about this sort of effervescence and sort of openness to to collaboration, to friendship, a kind of warmth underpinning a lot of these collaborations, which are sometimes spontaneous. And Maricela, the books, the poems of hers that are included in this anthology, are come before a book of hers, which I have been translating more recently. But I guess I would just like to take a moment just to express my admiration for Maricela as a poet and as a person. Her work is profoundly generous in a way that I think you will hear when we read a poem of hers in both English and Spanish. But it really is the generosity that her work shows towards the natural world, toward the networks of people who are part of her own personal and poetic imaginary, that reminds me constantly why I love poetry and why I love translating, is the chance to be sort of invited in to these networks of relationships and systems like tree roots. You know, the book that I'm translating of hers has a great deal to do with communication among species, among plants, among trees. And I think there's something, not in when people use the word poetic as an adjective, but I mean poetic in the sense that it's all about systems of communication and how we can deepen them. Maricela, no sé si quieras agregar algo.
Después de todo eso. Thank you very much for thank you very much to Kit, Aeromoto, Tatiana for the readings, and to Gato Negro for this book to celebrate the poesy, the poetry, and the party. Because we know that poetry is another word to say party, and another word to say friendship and kindness and generosity. And this is in this book and in your words, Robin. Thank you very much for your words. Ahora ya voy a hablar en español porque mi inglés de secundaria pública es un poco pobre. Sin embargo, estoy muy, muy conmovida y muy contenta de ver a tantos colegas, a tantos amigos y a tantas personas queridas en este libro, en estos salones de belleza que hacen un honor maravilloso al Salón de Belleza de Mario. Que bueno, sí, el amor al arte, como decían hace rato, es algo que impulsa muchísimo todos estos proyectos. El proyecto Aeromoto también es una belleza extraordinaria, generosa, y sobre todo que nos hace pensar en dónde verdaderamente está la riqueza, ¿no? La riqueza justo está en esta posibilidad de compartir y estar en un mismo espacio haciendo y diciendo cosas para comunicarnos, ¿no? Unos con otros y encontrar o inventar otras maneras también para que este mundo tenga mejor suerte que la que ha tenido hasta ahora, como dice Szymborska, ¿no? Bueno, y pues ahora quizá nos quede escuchar ese poema maravilloso de cumpleaños, Robin. No sé si ya esté.
Sí, aquí lo tengo.
Y después platicamos otro poquito.
Thank you, Maricela. Ay, a ti. This poem has the not terribly original title of Birthday Poem. Pain lives in the atmosphere like electricity. Who can blame it for being here first? Some days on the metro, I can hardly bear not touching my lips to the neck of whomever's in front of me. So-and-so's frail nape, his grim mole, her translucent hairs. So much can happen to the body. Sciatica, waterboarding, migraines, rubber bullets, melanoma, severed hands mispaired in plastic bags and flung to the part of the highway we call shoulder. I know the list's flippancy is dangerous, that pain inflicted and organic are unequal, but both are pain. I'm more religious than I used to think, or something. I expect my turn. I brush A's back with my fingertips as if he were already wounded. I want to know if I possess the kind of salve I know this life will call for. There are bones that ache forever, eyes blotted out by nitric acid, groins sundered in childbirth, a woman I knew from sixth grade typing class who died after subsisting on black coffee for longer than the lifespan of a periodic cicada. My physical therapist tapes my kneecap with electrodes neat as miniature lily pads. My muscles shudder. Later, she uses a needle and I cry out with a sound I've never made in front of anyone who has never been inside me. I'm sorry, she murmurs, steady even then. Forgive me, I'm sorry. What happens to the human cells that are looked upon with love? And to the ones that do the looking. There was an afternoon with A in a room on the coast. We lay in bed with the whole of our skins almost motionless against each other, almost glowing, a couple hours before the sunburn remembered to hurt us. And we looked at each other. Look, gout swell. Look, arm stump. Look, cesarean scar. Frostbite, knife wound, and you too, soft sternum still intact. Behold the blood invisible. Feel your own clean thrum. Today, I'm 30. This is the gift I am giving my body. This is the gift I am giving my body. Listo.
Wow. Maricela, can we read one of yours?
Okay.
¿Seguimos?
Sí.
Bueno, voy. Okay.
Just give me a minute, please.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
Perdón.
The Maricela. Bravo, Robin.
Gracias.
Wow, sí.
It was like the first poetry reading I've been doing in ages. It was amazing.
Okay.
I just had this image of being at Aeromoto the last time I went to Aeromoto, and there were so many of us in the same place, and I was sitting on the floor and there were stools and dogs everywhere. It's hard to imagine right now.
Sochi was there.
Sochi was there. Mario Valentin's dog was there.
Remember that meeting where Sochi was chewing a bone during a whole session, like 40 minutes, just like this background noise.
Chupando el hueso.
Okay, now we have it. It's on. So, Maricela, I have your poem here. It's the one called Poem in which the Beatus Seal is resumed.
Okay.
Okay. Perfect.
Bueno, voy a leer este poema que fue de los primeros que Robin generosamente comenzó a traducir. Y bueno, ahora ya tradujo el librito de la célula. Bueno, ha sido una relación muy generosa, un trabajo muy cuidadoso y atento el que hace Robin con los poemas, entonces pues siempre me siento muy muy agradecida y muy contenta de trabajar con ella. Y bueno, vamos a leer poema en que se retoma el Beato Sile. No sé qué, pero yo hoy ni mis muertos, con Mahler y toda la cosa, ni Pearl Jam, ni la santa suerte de vivir en un departamento sin jardín interior-exterior, ni una plantita, vamos, ni sapos, palmerines. Pastizales, no concreto la imagen, la heráldica de cada cosa, los ingenios azucareros, por ejemplo, sin dulce nada, un terroncito. Sabíamos que se nos iba a subir el azúcar a las barbas. ¿Habrá entonces que sintetizar proteínas, carbohidratos, semen sintético, azúcar fermentado, radical, OH, alcohol? Con todo, ni la química ni la biología entiendo. Nadie sacó oro de las piedras, tampoco vida eterna. Benditos, pierdo los dientes, el cabello, las uñas crecen, se entierran con los años. A los señores del Believe or Not, un hombre de indio pakistano de Almería, exóticos lugares modernistas, no gustaba de cortarse las uñas y de todo le hacían hasta subirle los calzones. 42 centímetros de calcio y años y años y años de sacrificio para que las uñas crecieran tangencialmente. Si así los pechos crecieran, Dolly Parton seríamos, qué cosa, pechos como melones, melus, melitus, de nuevo la dulzura, baladas, Daphne y Chloe cosechando melones del verano. Pese a que los pechos no crecen después de los 18, a menos que la gestación y no amamantes, pero se cuelgan como el cordón del teléfono, yo te llamo, o la piola del ahorcado. Después de todo, no somos eternos. Usemos del abril y mayo, que ya vendrá el agosto. Una golondrina de sí sola no hace verano. No crecen los pechos ni las uñas, créalo o no. Polvo seremos, y a estas alturas, vaya a saber si polvo enamorado. Quizá enormes pechos consagrados por el celuloide, los platillos malerianos, ¿qué otra cosa? El azúcar se disuelve, te friega los dientes y las arterias. Por eso los ingenios y solo te pagan las horas de la zafra. Zafremos palabras dulces del verano, ferméntense que ardan, radical OH. También mis muertos, scripta manem, todo se combustiona, los cuerpos se corrompen, desaparecen, el pelo, las uñas, polvo, polvo, nada.
¡Bravo!
I love this poem.
Oh, muchas gracias.
Shall we hear it in English too?
Yes!
Okay.
I'm gonna just put the other.
Here is my English translation of the poem that Maricela has just read, poem in which the Beatus Ile is resumed. What do I know but me today, not even my dead with Mahler and everything, not even Pearl Jam, not even the blessed luck of living in an apartment with no inner outer garden, not even a little plant, you know, or palms or succulents, just pastures. I can't affix the image, the heraldry of everything. For example, sugar factories, nothing unsweetened, a tiny cube. We knew the sugar would revolt. We'll have to cook up proteins, carbohydrates, synthetic semen, fermented sugar, alcohol, OH. That said, I don't understand chemistry or biology. No one drew gold from rocks, let alone eternal life. Bless them. I lose my teeth, my hair. Nails grow ingrown over the years. As for the believe it or not, sirs, a man from India or Pakistan or Almeria, exotic modernist places, stopped cutting his nails, and so his women did everything, even pulling up his underwear. 42 centimeters of calcium and years and years and years of sacrifice so that his nails would grow tangentially. If that's how breasts grew, we'd all be Dolly Parton. Imagine that. Breasts like melons, melus melitus, again the sweetness, ballads, Daphne and Chloe picking summer melons. Though breasts stop growing at 18, unless you gestate and you never nurse, but they hang down like a telephone cord. I'll call you or a hanged man's rope. In the end, we're not eternal. Let's enjoy April and May because August is on its way. One swallow doesn't make a summer. Breasts don't grow and nails don't either, believe it or not. We shall be dust, and at this rate, dust in love? Who knows? Perhaps enormous breasts that celluloid consecrates, malarian symbols. What else? Sugar dissolves. It wrecks your teeth and arteries, hence the factories, and they'll only pay your hours straining in the fields. Let's strain sweet summer words, ferment until they burn OH, and to my dead scripta manent, everything combusts, bodies rot and disappear, hair, nails, dust, dust, nothing. Mariel.
Bravo.
A ver, tal vez para terminar, I would like to add one invitation from our place as publishers, and on the context where this is going to be broadcast, which is the section Friendly Fire of the Printed Matter Art Center, which is like the section for political projects that in many ways for us this is also like a political book in a sense, understanding that very, very broad level, like the poetry, the sense of destruction that always involves, no? But also like to remark, to celebrate like this common space, this sense of community, in Mexico and the States, which is a real space that somehow for us has been very important. And keeping in mind that all this process took place in between the Trump years, and somehow there was a parallel universe of happy community, of generosity, and mutual translation, somehow denying. How would you translate desmintiendo?
Disproving, refuting.
Yeah. Refuting,
showing the lie of.
And showing like there is like this other side of that relation of a true community. I don't know. And somehow to put visibility on that community, which is also has a there's a genealogy of this and a long tradition of exchanges on that level that somehow is still alive, no? For us was also a consideration in terms of how this book has to circulate, no? That's something that matters to us.
I think I think that's a wrap.
So hopefully the book is going to be ready for the moment of the broadcasting of this in about 2 weeks. You can order the book through our new online shop, and hopefully very soon on many bookstores here in Mexico and in the United States. So.
Thank you all for coming.
And thank you to all the people involved in this. Thank you, Kit, for the trust to make this project together. And thank you, Jerónimo, and thank you, Robin.
Maricela.
Igualmente. Gracias, Kit.
Thank you all so much.
It's been a pleasure. So, adios.
Dios.
Hasta pronto.
Take care.
Cuídense mucho.
Quédense en casa.
Hasta pronto para una presentación real aquí.
Yeah. Sí.
Thank you, Printed Matter.
Thank you, Printed Matter. Dime cuando tú vas a volver.